And you know what? Kind of all this message that the Lord's giving me tonight, we're going to be in three books tonight. We're going to be in Matthew, Romans, and Amos. Amos. 16, verse 16, Matthew 2, 16. Brother Denver, would you bless the message tonight?
Father, Lord, thank you again. We just want to make it out here, Lord. Lord, we hope you would bless the message, don't you, Lord, Father? But Father, we need to give you the elevation. We need to Father, you listen and understand, Lord.
Amen. Matthew
2,
16, and we read this verse a minute ago. Then Herod, when he saw that he was mocked of the wise men, was exceeding wroth, and sent forth and slew all the children that were in Bethlehem, and in all the coast thereof, from 2 years old and under, according to the time which we had diligently inquired of the wise men. Killed them, Brother Denver. Slaughtered them children to keep Christ out of the way. Amos chapter 7. Amos chapter 7, verses, starting in verse 7, Thus he showed me, and behold, the Lord stood upon a wall made by a plumb line, with a plumb line in his hand. Y'all know what a plumb line is? A plumb line, before that they had the invent of levels, y'all know what a level is, those things that carpenters use that cut little bubbles in the little glass tubes. They had a plumb line. And you'd have a string or twine, something that was rope-like, and on the end of it you would have a weight. And of course, what does gravity do to things that are weighted? It makes a straight line. And so they would hang a plumb line, and they would build walls level to the string that was hanging off the plumb line. That's how they knew they had the wall straight, was because of the plumb line. Amen? So that's what a plumb line is. I actually thought about texting Kyle and asking him, hey, girls, we're going to have to move that tree. I can't stand not looking at Kyle. He's buried back there. I look up and I see this big tree. It's like I'm calling the tree Kyle. Yeah. I thought about texting Kyle and seeing if he had a plumb line. But, now notice what he said. It said, the Lord stood upon a wall made by what? A plumb line. Now he was standing on a wall built straight by a plumb line. In other words, it was a good made wall. With a plumb line in his hand. In other words, not only was the Lord standing on it, but he was holding a plumb line sitting on that straight wall. And the Lord said unto me, Amos was a farmer, by the way. Amos, what seest thou? And I said, a plumb line. Then said the Lord, behold, I will set a plumb line in the midst of my people Israel. I will not again pass by them anymore. And the high places of Isaac shall be desolate, and the sanctuaries of Israel shall be laid waste, and I will rise against the house of Jeroboam with the sword. Now, did you notice that? He said, I will set a plumb line in the midst of my people, Israel. Now, let's go to Romans 8. I usually don't cover all my verses before I get started, but I feel good tonight. Romans 8, 34. Powerful verse when you put it in this context. He said, who is he that condemneth? Uh-oh. Talk about condemnation now. We ain't supposed to be preaching on that, Pastor Bill. 8:34 says, who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died. Yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Boy, ain't that powerful? The very one that condemns me is the one who's pleading my case. Now you say, well, how's he condemning me? We're going to talk about that life right here in a minute. Going back to the book of Matthew for a moment and what Herod did, Brother Scott, we find that Herod committed an awful atrocity, killing those children. Slaughter them. Pharaoh done the same thing, slaughtering the children of Israel. Herod seen a threat, Sister Lafferty. Herod seen a threat to his throne. If there was a king born that was going to inherit the king of David, Brother Denver, he was going to lose everything he had. And he was willing to keep a hold of what he had by any means necessary. And if that meant he had to kill some innocent babies, he was all right by that. And see, we got a world a lot like that right now. That they are threatened, glory to God, by what it is that we have and what it is that we serve. Who it is that we serve. You say, why, Sean? Why are they threatened by it? We see the threat, right? I mean, I don't have to sit here and linger on about the threat made, the attack on Christianity. I think sometimes we get a little case of martyrdom, Sister Lori, and we look forward to being persecuted, or we look forward to the attack. But even all that aside and all those things, Sister Diane, we see the attack on Christianity. I was reading the other day, and I believe it was Minnesota, and they had a Christmas play, like a choral singing, and they sung Christmas carols, and they sung some Jewish hymns, and then they sung an Islamic hymn right along with it. Allah Akbar was one of the lines. It was for the holy month of Ramadan on the Israeli calendar. Boy, they sung that right along with O Holy Night and whatever else they done. There's an attack on Christianity. We're not allowed to say the word Jesus out in public. Where our children are not allowed to wear t-shirts in their schools. Now I can see, praise God, that a lot of our schools ain't that bad. May Valley is very open-minded. They've done a program over in Sarisville at South McGoffin, and it was Christian from the beginning to the end, depicting the nativity and everything that went on. Glory to God. I'm not saying it's being excluded from everywhere, but it doesn't go a week that we're finding somebody complaining about Jesus somewhere. Glory to God. But you know what? There's bold people standing up, and I want to throw this in before I forget. And there was a Santa Claus down in South Carolina sitting in a mall. And this little 4-year-old boy climbs up in his lap, and Santa says, "What do you want?" And that little boy says, "I want a train." And he says, "I want something else," or whatever. And Santa says, "What?" And he had read about this little boy, heard about it from his grandmother's prayer line on Facebook, prayer group on Facebook. And this 2-year-old baby in Las Vegas, Nevada is on life support. And that little 4-year-old boy looks at Santa Claus, and he said that he wanted for Christmas was he wanted Santa Claus to pray for that baby. You know what Santa Claus did? He said, "We'll pray for it right now." Woo! And out there in the middle of that mall, he climbed out of that seat, and somebody took a picture of it. It's all over Facebook. And there's old Santa Claus with his big beard and his red suit, now kneeling right down next to that cutest little old boy you ever seen, son, and them praying for that baby. Thank God we got people that ain't willing to back up like the Lycanses and the other that stood this week. Glory to God. Because you see, the world sees what they're afraid of. The world sees what threatens what they have, and they don't want rid of it. You see, Satan is the prince of the power of the air. He's the ruler of this earth. You say, what? Ephesians. Go back and read it. That's what Paul called him. He called him the ruler, the prince of the power of the air. That means, Brother Denver, he rules from the dirt to the heavens. That's his. I can prove it again. He told Christ, he said, "You bow down and worship me." He showed him all the kingdoms of the world. And he said, "They're mine to give if you just bow down." And see, if you're not serving God, then you're serving Satan. And when all of a sudden you see the real thing, then, Brian, that means you're going to have to give up the worldly thing. Just like Herod knew that he was going to have to give up his throne if that real king was born. And he'd done what he had to do. And see, we're starting to see the world do what they've got to do, Sister Danielle, in order to keep a hold of their worldly things. The book of Revelation, after plague upon plague come upon them, and they said for all this they wouldn't repent. And they would stand and they would curse God and die. Or curse God. And you think about that. And we're facing that. Now, I know it can get worse. I'm not trying to over-dramatize the reality of the situation we're in, but just a few miles away, they shut down what we all thought was a mainstay of the Christmas holiday. Amen? It's a little bit worse than we want to admit, but probably not as bad as we thought. But the world don't want to see it because the world don't want nothing to do with it. Because it requires action. I love what Kim Walker says in that song of Jesus Culture when they do that rendition of the song, How He Loves Us. She said, if you'd encountered the love of God, you'd know. Because once you've encountered the love of God, you're never the same. And you see, when they encounter the real God, Sister Lord, people ain't the same. They can deny Him. They can lie about it. They can shut it out. They can bottle it. They can criticize it. They can burn it. They can kill it. Somebody ought to hear me tonight. They can do with it what they want, but it don't change the fact, Brother Brown, that it's done too late. They done encountered the real God. Glory. You think about that. Y'all gonna have to get with me. Because we're getting ready to talk about a plumb line. You say, well, why is Jesus so bad? Because Romans 8:34 says that Jesus is the one that brings condemnation. You said, but it goes on in that verse to say that He's standing on the right hand of God and that He's making intercession for us. Well, let me tell you, it's because of His life that we're condemned. As a brother that I knew down in Opelika, Alabama by the name of Brother David Treadwell. Brother David Treadwell pastored a Pentecostal Holiness church down there, and he wrote a lot of music. He's a master musician, lyricist. He was really good at writing and singing. And he wrote a song, and one of the ending lines in the verse was talking about Christ coming to earth, and it said, to prove unto man that they could live right. Uh-oh. I'm a-saying that when Christ walked the earth, Sister Lori, that He proved unto man that we could walk in the undefiled righteousness of God. And because that Christ done it as a man, Sister Lori, there was a standard set by which I must be measured. And if I must be measured by the standard of Christ without the mercies of Christ, then Brother Scott, I'm going to fall short. And the world realizes that if they're not measuring up to what Jesus did, then glory to God and what Jesus lived, then they're not living it right. And they're going to have to give up the world. And the world don't want to give up the world because there is pleasure in sin for a season. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
They don't want to have to give that up. And so a few hundred years before Christ ever come, old Amos was out farming or herding, whatever he done for a living, an uneducated man, not of the family of the prophets, not of the tribe of Levi. He was just a dude out working the field, and God called him, and the Lord showed him a wall. And that wall was a pretty wall, Brother Scott, and it was a straight wall, and it was a solid built wall. And Brother Denver, that wall was just perfectly lined up from top to bottom. And we found that the Lord was standing on top of that wall, and He was holding that plumb line. And I don't know, He might have been standing up high with a big longing, He might have been down on His knee, but He was on top of that wall of that plumb line. And Amos could see with that plumb line that wall was perfect, Sister Diane. And the Lord said, Amos, what do you see? And He didn't comment on the wall. He commented on the plumb line because the wall was the product of the plumb line. The plumb line is what made the wall. And Amos said, I see the plumb line. And He said, I'm going to set a plumb line in my people Israel. And He said, I'm not going to fool with them anymore because I'm going to give them the standard. I'm going to give them the right way. I'm going to show them the way, the truth, and the life. And they're going to be measured by the plumb line. And that plumb line is Jesus Christ. And that plumb line walked all in the earth. And that plumb line was born on Christmas. Somebody ought to say amen. Glory.
Glory.
Woo.
Glory. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
And that plumb line come out of a favored woman of God.
Come on.
And that plumb line grew up to be a man of God.
Come on.
The Son of God. undefiled by the world, but tempted in every way like that we was. And so he laid a plumb line in the middle of Israel. Somebody ought to hear that tonight.
Come on.
He raised a standard up, Bill, that I got to live by. And you know what? Listen, I ain't taking nothing away from grace and mercy because I ain't Jesus. And I'm not born that way of God that he was. I'm not half God like Jesus was, or all God, all man, whatever, however you want to describe that scenario. God knew when he set that plumb line, Brother Bill, that we wouldn't be able to live the standard that Jesus lived. But he proved to us, Sister Diane, that it could be done if we got in the right way with him.
Come on.
And out of that plumb line, out of that wall that was built, we'll get to that wall in a minute. Out of that plumb line came mercy and grace out of a tomb on the third day. Amen?
Come on.
And it's because of that mercy and grace that God gives me liberty and favor. Lamentation says his mercies are renewed every morning. 2 Peter 3:9, he's not slack, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering.
Amen.
That it all might find salvation.
Come on.
I misquote that, but you know what I'm driving at. Amen? And so that plumb line, the very plumb line that proved that we could walk in perfection, now goes to the Father and says, Daddy, listen, they need some help. Come on. It's that same plumb line that we're measured by that says, Daddy, listen, I know you're looking at what holiness is, but you accepted my sacrifice that they made of me. You know, forgive them, Daddy. And you know what? If it wasn't for that mercy, Sister Kathy, I wouldn't have nothing. I would fail that plumb line. But you know what? With the plumb line on my side, oh, glory. Oh, have mercy. Jesus said that if we believed on him, that him and his Father would come live on the inside of me.
That's right.
Amen. Oh, no, Lord, people have hit before all this get. So, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. I paraphrased about 14 verses right there. And all of a sudden, the Word, who was with God and was made flesh, walks around on the earth a perfect plumb line, and he says, a perfect example, if you've missed what that plumb line is, a perfect example, he says he and his Father will live on the inside of me.
Yes.
That means not only am I holding the plumb line in my hand, glory to God, I got the plumb line, Brother Bryant, on the inside of me. Have mercy. And I know that I fail him. But glory to God, with the mercy and the grace of God and the plumb line in my heart and the plumb line in my hand, Sister Lori, I can walk holy before my God. Somebody ought to say amen. I can lift up holy hands. I can become what he wants me to be. You say, Shawn, you're preaching holiness. I guess I am, because he said, be ye holy as I am holy.
Amen. Amen.
Listen, if it couldn't be done, Jesus wouldn't have done it.
That's right.
If it couldn't be done, Philippians 4:13 wouldn't have said, you can do all things through Christ who strengthens thee. If it couldn't be done, glory to God, Romans 8 wouldn't have said, all things work to the good of those that love the Lord. Somebody ought to hear me tonight, because we got a perfect plumb line that is standing in our midst, and we got a perfect plumb line that's living in our heart for the neighbor that we're alive. To walk perfect and holy before the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
And out of that plumb line is built a perfect wall. And that perfect wall is the bride of Christ. That perfect wall, Brother Scott, is the church. Amen. A church that is raised up by the plumb line.
Come on.
Oh, man. Y'all going to have to backtrack straight. Straightway.
Come on.
They're raised up by the plumb line, Pastor Bill.
Come on.
You hear that, Pastor Denver? It's raised up the straightway by the plumb line.
Glory.
Come on. He said, there's no other name under heaven for which men must be saved. Oh, listen. I'm going to step on some toes. Probably not in this building. But somebody ain't going to like it. Because Muhammad and Allah ain't taking me to heaven. Come on. Joseph Smith ain't taking me to heaven. Glory to God. Hinduism, Buddhism, Taoism, you name it, ism ain't taking me nowhere.
That's right.
There's one name under heaven for which we must be saved. One name.
One name, Jesus.
One name. A plumb line. The perfect sacrifice.
Glory.
Woo! Yeah.
Glory, hallelujah.
Listen.
Oh, that's powerful.
My brother David said something to me I'd never realized. I feel like throwing this in there. When they got them sacrifices ready in the Old Testament, Brother Denver, they had to be cleansed. And they had to be clean. They were ready to be sacrificed. And here come old Jesus walking down to the water to John the Baptist. And old John said, I'm not even fit to unbuckle your shoes.
Come on.
He said, baptize me. He said, you ought to be baptizing me. He said, suffer me, John. And he might have said it like this. Suffer me, John, because I'm going to be a sacrifice. And I got to be prepared. I got to be cleansed. Glory to God. Because I'm the plumb line that the prophet Amos talks about. When the Lord stood on the wall and showed the rock wall that was built.
Thank you, Lord.
He said, I'm laying down a standard, Peter. And on this rock.
Yeah.
Oh, somebody ought to hear me.
On this
he said, because if you build it on the sand, it ain't going to stand. He said, but if you build it on the rock, come on.
All right.
He didn't say not Peter being the rock.
Come on.
But Christ was the rock.
That's right.
Christ might have got a little bit more rock-like later, but he was like a whole lot of sand early on.
Yeah.
Amen.
Come on.
And that perfect church was built on the perfect level rock by the perfect plumb line that come down out of heaven. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
And the world can't stand it. Amen. Sister Danielle King Hired couldn't stand it because what he had was threatened.
Come on.
The rich young ruler come and said, what I've got to do to follow you? And Jesus said, keep all the commandments. He said, I've done it from my childhood up. No doubt. No doubt, Brother Denver. He thought, I got this. Yeah.
Yeah.
Denver said he probably thought he had it made. I bet he thought, yeah, I'm in.
Yeah.
Woo. And Jesus said, well, sell all your goods and give to the poor. And he said he went away sad, Brother Bryant.
Sorrowful.
Sorrowful. Because he had much. He was very wealthy. There was another one who came. Nope, let's go this way with it. There was one who came. Jesus came to the well and he sat down and here come a woman. He got her to give him a drink of water. And he started talking to her about water. And he said, if you had the water in front of you, he said, you wouldn't thirst anymore. He said, you know, let's tie it in with our metaphor of the night. He said, you know, sister, he said, if you was walking with the plumb line that's in front of you, you wouldn't be sinning no more. And she said, I want this water because I don't want to thirst. And the Lord said, well, that's cool. You can drink of it. He said, you're looking at the Christ. She said, go tell your husband. She said, I ain't married. And Jesus said, that's right, you ain't. He said, you done been married 5 times and you shackled with number 6. Amen.
Come on.
She's called spade spade. It's what it was. It's become accepted. I'll give a shout out to the First Baptist brother of ours, a pastor. This couple got saved. He got them married before he baptized them. So praise the Lord.
All right.
It's all right. Amen. I can't fault that doctrine. Amen.
Come on.
And he said, she said, yeah, that's right. That's right. I said, you're right. And he said, go and sin no more. Oh, holy cow. That means the plumb line just put her on the straight and narrow. The plumb line just told her that she couldn't do what she'd been doing. The plumb line just told her how to straighten her wall out. Glory to God. Amen. Before she could drink, come on, before she drank that water, she had to get that water out. Glory. You think about that. Man, ain't that awesome?
Yeah.
And you think about how many people in the, when he healed them, Danielle, he would tell them, he would say, go and sin no more. The woman caught in adultery and they were looking to stone her. We was preaching on that a little while back about how they'd erode in the ground, and that woman looked up and all of her accusers was gone, and the Lord picked her up and he said, go and sin no more. Glory to God. Now you think about that. You see, when you encounter the love of God, you're never the same. You say, well, how do I know when I've encountered the love of God? If you encounter the face of God, if you encounter Jesus, if you encounter a real Christian, you've encountered love. Because God is love.
Amen.
Uh-oh, we better hold on. It's about to get real. Because that means if God is love, then that plumb line is love. And if God is love, then the church ought to be love. And that perfect bride will be raised up in love. Glory to God. Somebody ought to hear.
Come on, brother.
Woo! Preach. Yeah, man. It's all right. See, if you've encountered love, you've encountered God. Real love. Genuine Christian charity,
come on.
Love in action, and you've encountered God, and you will never be the same. And that forces people, glory, to make a decision like King Herod did. Because if you know what the reality is, then you're about to lose everything in the palm of your hand. I'm about to lose my kingdom, Brother Scott. I'm about to lose the person I'm living with. I'm about to lose my riches. I'm about to lose my drugs. I'm about to lose my friends. I'm about to lose my lot in life. I'm about to lose my status. I'm about to lose my family. Somebody ought to hear it tonight. Come on. I'm about to lose my homosexuality. I'm about to lose my love life. I'm about to lose my bar hopping. Glory to God. I'm about to lose my lying tongue. I'm about to lose my gossiping spirit. Somebody ought to hear it tonight. Come on. I'm about to lose my backstabbing. I'm about to lose. Oh, somebody ought to hear it. And glory to God. And if you don't think a sinner loves sin, then you ought to remember when you was a sinner. Because I'm about guarantee you loved what you were doing back then.
Yeah, come on.
And you probably wouldn't have stopped for love nor money. Amen? I got some of you nodding, yeah.
Come on.
And you'll do what you got to do to hang on to that.
Come on.
Oh, you'll promise them you'll go to church with them. You will, yeah, I'll come sometime. Or you avoid them, or you cut them off, or you hurt them, or you lie about them. Let me tell you something, you'll get so desperate to hang on to what you got that you'll stoop to all new lows. You will sneak and connive and everything else that you can do in order. Glory to God. Oh, have mercy, Jesus.
Come on.
To satisfy the lust of the flesh. Ooh, the lust of the eye and the lust of the flesh. Think about it. And the pride of life. Thank you, I was looking for that. And the pride of life. Have mercy. You think about that right there. There's a lot of good walls messed up, not by the plumb line, but because they refuse to recognize the plumb line as being the way, the truth, and the life. Amen? Man, tears me up. Glory. Herod knew that if that plumb line come, he was a had lad. Herod was an evil man. Herod was succeeded by another Herod who was some of his family. I forget who. Brother, nephew, somebody. There was a third Herod as well. There was three of them. And anyways, the second Herod, the first Herod killed the children to stop Jesus. The second Herod killed John the Baptist so he wouldn't have to know the truth. Amen. And if I remember right, the third Herod died and the worms eat his body. What he said on the throne.
and with evil individuals.
But the first one tried to stop Jesus, and the second one wiped out John the Baptist to fulfill the lust of his flesh. He was carrying on with his sister-in-law, and I think had married her perhaps, or was getting ready to. And the daughter danced. His lover's daughter danced before him. Now, just bear with me for just 2 minutes. And I don't want to digress too far, and I don't want to paint too much of a vivid picture, but let's put something together. First of all, it's just plain nasty he's with his sister-in-law. Period. Space. New sentence. His brother was alive. There wasn't no call for that. It was what it was. But he was having a big party, and a bunch of big rulers was in there. And here comes Philip's daughter, his brother's daughter. The woman he was carrying on with or married to now, his sister-in-law's child. Young woman, apparently good looking. And she was going to dance for him. And I'm just going to tell you what, I ain't never seen a dance that I would have promised anybody anything up to half the kingdom. So it tells me what she was doing probably wasn't a ballet. Amen? It tells me there was something a lot more worse going on. Because he said, I'll tell you what, I like that so good. He said, I'll give you everything up to half the kingdom. Holy cow, man. What?
Fulfill that lust.
Yeah, that's exactly. Fulfill the lust of the flesh is what that. Lust of the eye and the lust of the flesh. He said, I'll give you half the kingdom. She said, I don't want your kingdom. She said, I just want John the Baptist's head on a silver platter. On a charger. Said Herod hated to do it. Because
he was fond of John.
Kind of like John. Glory to God. How many people we know is fond of us? You know? Glory to God, but how many of them will sell us out in a heartbeat to keep a hold of their lust?
Come on.
How many of them will sell us out? I ain't talking about necessarily life or death, but I'm talking about our friendships. I'm talking about our relationship. We can take it down on a much, much less devious level. If you want to talk about that, how many of them will sell us out in a heartbeat to hold on to that? There's some people in my and Missy's life, youth that we have touched over the years. They love us desperately, and we love them desperately, but they don't love us or God enough to quit doing what they're doing and come home. Amen. It just is what it is. I love them all. I can't crack it no other way, can we, Missy? If they wanted God more than they wanted, if they wanted that plumb line, if they wanted love more than they wanted the world, glory to God, they'd come get it because they know where it is. They ain't no boast on me. It's just true. Amen. But he sold old John under the table. Not just to fulfill the lust. Because I guess he was king. He could have backed out if he wanted to. But pride got in the way because he made that promise in front of all them friends. All them so-called friends, all them rulers. He sold them right out, Sister Life. Just pulled it right out from under him. He said, well, I hate to do it. Kind of fond, old John. I guess since I said that, promise number one, number two, is all these people watching, I don't guess I can renegotiate. So I guess we'll just have to do it. How many people will sell out the plumb line? Glory to God. How many people will sell out the plumb line?
Come on.
How many people will build a crooked wall? Ooh, Sean, behind the enemy outside. How many of them will build a crooked church? Ooh, glory. How many of them will build it on money and build it on false doctrine and build it on false pretense? Glory to God. Come on, Jesus, his own disciples. Amen. They sold him out. Judas sold him out right under the table outright. The rest of them abandoned the plumb line.
Yeah.
Can you hear me? Glory. And Peter denied him. Man. You can't, do you hear what God is saying tonight? Let me tell you something. That child Jesus entered the world perfect. That plumb line coming to the world holding a straight line. And the people couldn't stand it then. Glory to God. Amen. And the people can't stand it now.
Amen.
That's true.
Amen. Come on,
just did what it is. Now, I won't go as far as to say our building is empty because if people are denying Jesus, I think we got too much crookedness in the church, Brother Bill, for me to accuse the world of all that. I think we've got a hand in that because we don't love the plumb line. We don't live by it, Sister Lord, like we ought to, Brother Jim. Amen? Right. Glory to God. Man, that just tears me up. They hated him when he came into the world, and they hate him now. Cain hated him. Can we say amen?
Amen.
Cain hated him.
Yeah.
Ahab hated him. I'd even go as far, Brother Scott, to say that David maybe hated him at one point because he committed a couple awful bad things. Mm-hmm. And you say hate's a strong word. He said, you're either for me or against me. Left or right, black and white, you love me. And he said, if you love me, you keep my commandments. And if you don't, you won't. And if you ain't loving, then you must be
hating.
Amen. Haters want to hate, I guess, right? That's what the saying is now. Glory to God. Well, you know what? Haters want to hate. Fine. They started hating when he came into the world. Well, I'll back it up even farther. We done said they started hating him after the creation. I'll tell you what old Jesus told them. He said, you slew the prophets. He said, you slew them between the altar and the door.
That's right.
Come on. They've hated God since God created man and man got a hold of knowledge. There's been people who's hated him. Because that with the recognition of God, the recognition of love, the recognition of the plumb line that walked perfect among us, says that I can't do anything I want to do and be okay. It says that I'm wrong. And there ain't nothing makes a human any madder than to tell them they're wrong when they don't want to be wrong. Amen? Amen. So we ask ourselves this question. Why is there a war on Christianity? I'm going to be honest with you. They've been war on Christianity from the beginning. We're just seeing an increase and a renewed effort. There was a French philosopher, and I really think it was Monier. And I always forget which one it was, but I believe it was him. But no, it was Voltaire. That's who it was. It was Voltaire who said that. And he said, I'm misquoting this, but this is the gist of it. He said, another 100 years, ain't nobody going to have any use for the Bible. That was in, I think, the 1700s or the 1800s. You know, he said, I ain't going to have any use for that.
Nietzsche
made a statement. He said, for all the modern purposes of man, God's dead. Well, I hate to tell you that Voltaire and Nietzsche have long rotted. And my God is still sitting on the throne.
Yeah, come on. Amen.
And Nietzsche and Voltaire and Judas Iscariot and Cain and Ahab have long become dust. But the Bible, the Word, the plumb line is still in print.
Yes, come on. Amen.
There's been more of them printed than any other work of literature in the world over.
Come on. They can't get rid of it.
They try to stomp it out. Glory to God, Hitler tried to kill not only God's people but destroy the Word of God. And Hitler's gone by the effort of his own hand.
Right.
And the Word of God and the people of God, the Jews, are still standing.
That's right.
Glory to God, oh Hitler, just fulfilled Bible prophecy. He was trying to destroy them, and when they come out of it, they got their own country back. Can somebody
yes.
say amen?
Come on, amen.
Glory, thank you, Lord.
They can't stand the truth, y'all. Now, that ain't to say that I'm supposed to be mean to them, because Jesus was never mean to them. The only people Jesus ever got mean with were the ones who were supposed to be living it and wasn't.
Right.
He was good to the people who needed him. He said the well had no need of his physician. The Pharisees wouldn't have him. He went to the people who would take him. And we've got to be good to them. We've got to show them love. You know why? Not because they're wrong, but because we have love and they need to see love. Just like that Jesus' perfect life stands to condemn us, our life of love will stand as a witness against those people that we come in contact with. in contact with. But Jesus didn't live the life of love to condemn us. He lived the life of love so he could love us. And I'm not supposed to live it so I can get them condemned. I'm supposed to live it so that they can have love. Amen? Condemnation is supposed to be the farthest thing from my mind, other than the fact that I want to get them out of it. Christ, I can prove it. Christ himself said, Lord, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Amen? There's a war on us. Fair statement. Amen? Maybe not as bad as it seems. Maybe worse. But we'll be faced with increasing things. Brother Scott made a statement a while ago. He said that we're even in a position now where we're subject to what we say in our pulpits, to the laws of the land. Amen? It's true. It's going to get worse as time goes on. And we're under attack. And we're under attack for the simple reason that the world can't stand the Plumbline. The world can't stand the baby Christ. The world can't stand the perfect resurrected Savior. The world can't stand true, unabated, undefiled, holy, and divine love.
Come on.
Can we say amen?
Amen.
So, I call us to be like Christ and to be the plumb line. Not arrogantly, but perfectly, sincerely. Holy as we know how to be holy. As best we can do, Brother Scott, what we're required of. As best we can do. Lord, that tears me up. And I call upon you to look that even from the birth of Christ, he was pursued to be destroyed. I call upon you to seek Christ in a pure and holy way. Not like the world would have it, because the world would have it has nothing to do with it. But I call you to seek him. I call you to be holy, as he is holy. You say, Shawn, are you perfect? No. I'm telling you to try. I'm telling you to try. I'm telling you to try. Amen? Amen. Can we give God a hand clap of praise?
Amen.
I don't feel to have an altar call tonight. I think that we're just going to sing Heart Herald the Angels Sing. And we're going to dismiss in prayer. Can we say amen to that?
Amen.
Give God another hand clap of praise. Amen. Pastor.